That's the name of the game. That is the name of the game. Keep your momentum going. So we're in June 2015 right now. And to keep the ball rolling is to succeed ultimately, right? And that's what we're aiming for. This is the month of miracles, where we realize that we have to begin to experience miracles. There isn't any other way around it. We can't get around that, because we have to experience what we have imagined as this massive simulation to help us prepare for the start of time. Since time will never start, what do we do with this massive simulation, this cosmos? We're just pretending that this is this is how we think time is going to be. It gives us opportunity to dress rehearsal, huge dress rehearsal for how time is going to be once, how we're going to experience it once time starts. So what do? We just set it all down, stop pretending, all vanishes. No, we keep it, but we change our preparation. Instead of preparing for time to start, we prepare for time not to start. We prepare for time not to start. So in this preparing for time not to start, then we experience the world differently. We experience what is called the miraculous. From the standpoint of, from the old perspective, it seems miraculous. From our standpoint, we'll gradually get used to it. So it just seems, well, this is the new normal. The miraculous is the new normal, actually, for us. The miraculous is the new normal for us. Now, practice is the key to success. And I've been doing that. Yesterday had the best practice I've ever had, and it was just hard to describe. Then this morning, again, I topped it. And you might say, this morning I topped it with even better. So I'm in the wow, sort of in the wow phase of those practices, and it's very important to identify the full stop in the wow phase. Otherwise, you'll think that you've stalled out. You think that you've gone dumb. You think that the path isn't working for you. But as soon as you recognize, hey, wait, maybe I'm in just in this shock phase from the great success I've been having, and maybe that's going to be temporary if I just recognize it and don't panic, and then I'll wait, be patient, and focus on it, and start working with it, and then I'll come out of that shock. Whereas if you take it the wrong way, then you will panic, and you'll start thinking that all this stuff isn't working. I've never succeeded. What's wrong with me? The cup is half empty. You'll take it. The cup is half empty. So this happened to me today. I was just feeling like so flat. Say, wow, how come I can't get going? What's wrong with me? And then I realized, hey, wait a minute. This morning I just spent like about 3 hours on the very best practice that I've ever experienced. And it was so profound, I just went into shock, actually. And so I'm still in that shock. And then by recognizing that, then I lightened up on myself and said, oh, okay, yeah. Yeah, I'm not failing. I'm succeeding so astonishingly that I'm temporarily astonished by it, actually. This is what's happening. So again, how does one succeed? By managing one's success. There's no other way. You have to become adept at managing your success. And by doing so, you will ultimately be the one that people refer to as the enlightened one. You will be that too. We all will be that eventually. The only difference is that those who have learned to manage their success and those who haven't yet learned to manage their success, so they're afraid of it. They're afraid of their success. It shocks them. They don't know what to do about it. So this is really a path of managing one's success. Now, wherever one is on the path, people have very different perspectives depending on where they're at with their success. So don't argue about anything with people. Don't argue. Someone might say, well, I see it differently. I see it this way. This fine. But don't argue about it. Simply continue to manage your success. And the better you get at that, the bigger the insights that will come. The better the practice that will come. I've been doing a practice which is just absolutely, just love it. Absolutely love it. It is so extraordinary. And it just occurred to me to do this. It just occurred to me because why? I was ready to handle the success of it. That's the only reason why it occurred to me. And you will feel like you're some kind of great, very creative, wonderfully talented on the spiritual path. When these breakthroughs occur to you, you say, wow, I'm really very, very talented at this. I'm a natural for it. I love it. And then you'll go into the shock of the success, and then you have to manage that shock, full stop in the wow, and not get down on yourself, not panic. This is how it goes. And then when you manage that properly, the next breakthrough will be even better, and even better, and even greater, and even greater. And it goes like this. And then you'll say, at some point you'll say, hey, if I keep going like this, I'm going to be, you know, like such and such, who's, you know, some great teacher or something, someone who's, you know, seen as, you know, enlightened and so divinely wise and all this. And say, if I keep going this way, I'm going to end up just like that. And then you have to say, wow. that shocks you even more. It's like, wow, can I really do this? You know, this. The answer is yes, of course, absolutely yes. The answer is yes. We can do that, and everyone will. Everyone will. It's just a matter, you have no choice but to learn to manage your success. There's no choice about it. Those who don't just continue to flounder. That's all. That's all. They just keep floundering and floundering and floundering and floundering until they start to learn to manage their success. This is the best way to look at everyone, all spirit, in this simulated preparation for time to start in this dream-like scenario where we're trying to simulate what time will be like. This is what the existence is. We're trying to simulate what time is going to be like and give us opportunity to prepare to figure out how we're going to function, because time is, in reality, there's no time, of course. And so we don't have any idea of how to function, would function under time. It seems like, you know, absolute ignorant about it. So we dream up this dream simulating what we believe, how we believe it will, existence will be like once time starts. This is what we've come up with, this world, this cosmos. It's fanciful. It's absolutely fanciful, because there isn't any such thing as time. Time will never start. So this is all just absolute whimsical, fanciful speculation, which is much ado about nothing, actually. The idea that all of this is set in stone, you know, the nature and vegetation and worlds and bodies is hilarious. It's not set in stone in the slightest. This is just our make-believe notion of what it might be like if time were to ever start. If time were to ever start, if our freedom were ever to be changed into time, then, you know, what would that be like? And we've just dreamed up. Like a dream, just like a dream. We've just dreamed this up, existence. We've dreamed it up so that we can then think that we can prepare. It's like if time starts, then we'll know what it's like. We'll be used to it. And so we keep trying to get more and more used to it. But really, we're just floundering. We're just floundering. Just floundering. Like a fish on a beach, just floundering, floundering, floundering. That's all we're doing. Eventually, we got to get back in the ocean and swim. There's no two ways about it. Other, you know, until we do that, we'll just keep floundering. So we have to, no choice, we have to manage our success. We must have success, which means other side of success is managing your success. Talk to people who are successful, and they say that it's easy to get to the top, really tough to stay there. It's, in other words, managing your success is the tough part of success. And so again, we have no choice but to be successful, totally successful, in setting down this useless dream that we have concocted out of our fanciful imagination. No choice to set it down. So we have to be successful. We can never avoid this. So, therefore, what do we have to do? We have to learn how to manage our success. It's impossible to get around this mandate. Impossible. And the difference, if you might look at some of the great ones who've dropped their, you know, belief that time is going to start, drop their arrogance, and we say, wow, they're so superior to us or whatever, just so amazing, like I can't even hardly understand it. Well, we have to be that way too. We have to get there. They learned to manage their success, and we have to also. So this is the most serious issue there is. Again, without learning to manage our success, we will not be successful. And to not be successful means to continue to flounder. Because again, this world is much ado about nothing. Absolutely, the cosmos is much ado about absolutely nothing. It's just a fanciful, whimsical play of wishful thinking of, I wonder what a kingdom of time would be like. But since there isn't any time, all this is not causative. We think that this is all causative. Only our imagination is causing it. Time isn't causing it at all. Not one bit is time causing any of this. We, spirit, mind, are causing all of it. We're imagining all of it. And since there isn't any time, there isn't any stone. There's no foundation to what we're imagining at all. We're just conjuring this up. Is fanciful speculation, and that's all it is entirely fanciful speculation with not a shred of reality to it, not a shred of reality to it. In terms of, since there's no time to cause it, how can it be an effective time? None of this is an effective time at all. Just a play of our imagination, and it's nothing more than that. It's not like we'll say, well, we've got it pretty close to how it's going to be like when time starts. Time will never start, so how can we say it's close to what would arise from time? There is no time, nothing can arise from time. So this is just, again, a play, much ado about nothing. It symbolizes nothing at all. Really, this whole cosmos symbolizes nothing at all, except the power of our creativity. It does symbolize that. So to honor our creativity, and because of a continuity fears of, we're so used to simulating, trying to get used to a simulation, a what if simulation, that we don't know if we could how to function in reality anymore. We keep thinking that floundering is our being. This floundering here is our being. We prepare for time not to start. We prepare for time not to start. We prepare for time not to start. And so, what is that like? Well, we can be, with this, we have a more of a foundation, don't we? Because reality then becomes our foundation. Since time is not starting, what does that mean? It means reality is not going to be changed. So if we prepare for time not to start, we're really preparing for reality to be real. Okay, we're really preparing for reality to be what it is, to be real. That's what we're preparing for. Time, we're preparing for time not to start. And in order to recognize that reality is still real, we need to recognize that this dream is just a dream. Okay, so we can bring in miracles into this dream, which help us realize that, oh, you know, this is only a dream, and all these so-called this is the way it is-ness of this dream is just fanciful imagination based on our willful whim, okay? And it doesn't actually, it's not real. Just like in a dream, you can change the dream if you want to, and just because you want to. That's right. You see, in other words, there's no laws in a dream that really hold, that bind the dreamer, right? There's no laws in a dream that bind the dreamer. You can have a dream with all these laws, and the dreamer decides, instead of this, I want it to be this way, and then just it changes like that. And then the dreamer who's dreaming the dream, I say, oh my gosh, there's a miracle happened in the dream. Look at this miracle. How miraculous it's changed. So we have to put ourselves through miracles. We have to absorb this and absorb the success of this and begin to recognize miracles. That's all. Which means an appearance where the dream appears differently than what we're used to. Why? Because we've changed our purpose for the dream. That's why. We used to have the purpose of this dream is for the purpose of preparing for time to start. And now we're using the dream to prepare for time not to start. So the nature of the dream changes for us. Nature of the dream changes for us. And then we gradually come to realize that it is just 100% a dream and nothing other than that. So if we can just smooth out this transition like this, and we've explained it very clearly and smoothed it out, then we can just move into it as a matter of fact. That's all. It's just a matter of fact. It's just a pragmatic step that has to be taken. You know, we don't need to, you know, we can enjoy it, we can get into it and all, but it's just a pragmatic step that has to be taken. How much disk space? Okay. Have a lot. We can go all day here. So we continue to keep the ball rolling and smoothing this transition out. We're at this time where we're now entering the age of miracles. Okay, those who are with getting with this. Okay, and the purpose is to start smoothing this out for everybody. Start smoothing it out. Okay, for everyone who wants to. Now, the world is going to hell for sure. It's going into severe floundering mode. Severe floundering mode. As we have turned our attention, the world in general has turned its attention away from managing spiritual success and attempting to simply intensify the simulation for time to start. The world is really beating the drums, pounding the drums, saying, time is about to start, time is about to start. We must really, really, really now focus on getting used to how is it going to be when time starts, you know? Like, what if we don't like, they were saying like, oh my God, you know, I don't feel right. If time starts, I don't feel quite ready. What's the problem? Maybe the problem is your gender. Oh yeah, yeah. Well, what I do? Just change your gender. It's okay when time starts. You don't feel quite right. You can change. Just change your gender. What if I don't like this orientation or that? Just change it. You know, and what happens? So people are freaking out. What happens? You know, time. They think time's ready to start, and of course we're never ready for time to start. We can never be ready for it. Actually, how can we be ready for what doesn't exist to start? It's not possible. So we always feel insecure. We always feel insecure. And so what they're doing is they're saying, well, the insecurity is because of this, or the insecurity is because of that, or the insecurity is this, or this. And you know, it's like, and so people are going to be saying like, oh my gosh, how I am right now, I just don't feel it's good enough. I haven't prepared well enough. Can I be someone else? Maybe someone else, you know, grass is greener, maybe over there. Maybe if I'm like that, and it'll be better. And of course, those who are promoting this whole beginning, you know, preparing for time, will say, yeah, that's probably the answer. You should give it a try. Let's be tolerant and of everything. Let's try everything out here. Let's make sure we have it nailed down. And so someone says, well, I don't know. I don't like my race. I got to change my race. I got to change my gender. I have to change my orientation. I have to change this. I have to change. Maybe, oh, sure, okay. Just try anything at all. They're becoming frantic. They're becoming absolutely frantic because they have conjured up in their minds that time is about to start. And when time starts, they call it the millennium. This is the belief that time is going to start. And that those who are prepared for time to start will then have this wonderful life that they'll be rewarded for all their loyalty to this issue of preparing for time to start. They'll be rewarded. And the ones that did not prepare and were not loyal to this idea are going to be cast into hell. You know, they're going to be burned forever. They're going to disappear. They're going to be annihilated. They're not going to bother us anymore. We'll be happy. Yeah, and And so all of this is going on, and it's getting wackier and wackier and wackier, you know. And people get up in the morning and say, you know, I don't quite feel right. Maybe today I want to be a woman. Okay, today I'm a woman. Next day says, yeah, this doesn't work. It's not working. I'll be a man today. Or today I'm going to be a man. And, you know, people are going to go through all this instability now. The world is absolutely, as they say, it's going to be like Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, Sodom and Gomorrah was a situation where they thought time was going to start. And so they were into this try anything mode, you know, absolutely. Fornication with everything, animals, people, children, everything. They were just absolutely besotted with how are we going to be happy once time starts? You know, how are we going to happy? What kind of body identity can I have and be happy with that body identity? And of course, we can never be happy with the idea of a body identity, okay? Or spirit. And it's never good enough. It's never good enough. So there's all sorts of drugs and just extremely perverse, decadent society at that time. And this is exactly where we're headed right now at this time. Is their quote unquote time. Okay, that's a different use of the term time. It's just conversational use of time. The world is believing that time is about to start. Time is about to start. So, a lot of people believe that when Jesus comes back, that he's going to start time. He said, okay, everybody, I told you to prepare now. I'm going to start time. No, Jesus, not only is he going to come back, he's already back. And he comes back for those who have seen through this delusion, who are realizing that there's no such thing as time. It will never start. And those are the ones he's come back for. Those are the sheep, the saved ones. The others are the goats to eat anything. See, goats lead anything. Those who are preparing for time will just try anything to feel right about it, to feel right about it. And this started in the 60s, strongly. The free love movement started with birth control pill, actually, and the free love movement and all this stuff. And it's continued on in its riotous path since then. These people are driven by this dread that time is about to start. And they better find a happy body identity by then, and a happy lifestyle which they can, you know, be happy then. And so they're going bonkers. They're going bonkers. This is and so we're told, and the prophecy tells us, in the end times it'll be like the days of Noah, which is Sodom and Gomorrah. It will be an evil and adulterous generation, where meaning basically that they'll just be into any sort of body freakishness possible, just looking for you. See, they get, you know, good morning and say, wow, I just don't feel right. I got to get like, you know, 10 more tattoos today, and I got to do a bunch of body modification today, and I have to fornicate with five people today, and I have to, you know, on and on and on and on. Today I have to be this and this and this, and tomorrow, no, completely different. So they have all these parades. These people who are freaking out about this have all these parades and celebrations now, where they're all walking along dressed up in all sorts of bizarre, freakish body costumes, trying to say, is this attractive enough? Do I, you know, is this sexy enough? Is this a time? Is this going to make me happy in time enough? And popping drugs, fornicating, taking, you know, having parties, listening to music, dancing wildly, and all this kind of stuff. This is what's going on. They think that time is about ready to start, and so they're freaking out. Now, of course, those who have been listening to the gospel, the good news that there's no such thing as time, they're saying, like, you know, like scratching their heads, say, what in the world is going on? Well, they know the end times are going on, and they say, wow, I don't want to be caught up in this. And it's like, it's very viral. It's very viral, all this stuff. And it's like a virus. People are getting infected. More and more people are getting infected with it every day. And you don't want to be infected with that, actually. And there are those who are believing in time more than others, and those seem to be the ringleaders, the activists of this whole thing. Those are the ones who are really freaking out. And they're so frantic, they convince the others that there really is this severe problem coming very soon about time starting, and they're not ready for it. And so this activism that's been boiling since the 60s, just boiling, now it's just like a pressure cooker. It's under so much pressure. These people are just basically screaming at you constantly from the television, throughout culture, through the news media, everyone saying, look, you got to get into this. You got to embrace what we're talking about. Otherwise, you're doomed. You're doomed. You're doomed. You're going to be left behind. You're going to be evil. You're terrible. And the pressure is on people so severely the fact is that people can crack under this pressure, and then suddenly they'll say, one day they'll wake up and say, oh my gosh, all my life I've been a woman my whole life, but I realize I'm really a man. I realize that today. Or I've been straight my whole life, and suddenly I realize, I'm really gay, or something like that. Or I've been gay my whole life, and I realize suddenly I'm straight. I was a gay woman, suddenly I realize I'm a straight man today. I got all these tattoos, and suddenly I realize I got to take them all off today. And then later on, I got to put them all back, And then realize, wait a minute, I'm this, I'm that. And, so this is the culture that we're in. This culture that we're in. And it's a terrible culture. And we're all like struggling with this because we're being hammered by all this identity freak out that's taking place right now. It's like they say, I don't think I have the right identity for time. It's impossible to have the right identity for time because time doesn't exist. That's like saying that I don't have the right identity for non-existence or non-reality. I don't have that right identity. Hello, bird. A little bird came down on... And so that whatever they feel they're identifying with right now, they say, that's not it. That's not it. See, that's non-existence. I don't feel right about non-existence. This represents non-existence. I don't feel right about it. So I got to change my identity today. And again, so they're trying to help one another out. They're so sure that this is going to happen. They look at those who are not doing this and just saying, wow, you people are just, lazy. You're stupid. Basically, they say we're stupid, ignorant, bigoted, all this stuff. Well, that's not the case at all. It's not the case at all. That's not really what's happening at all. They misidentify what's happening entirely. Is we realize that time is never going to start, so we don't have to go through all this foolishness. We don't have to have a body identity at all. We don't have to have a body identity. So whatever happens to be the body, just let it be whatever it is. Don't even worry about it. We don't need a body identity. Time will never start. You see, for not for time to start, that reality can't be real. That means our identity as spirit, as formless spirit, is no longer formless spirit. It would have to be something time-space-process-form based, which means it would have to be some kind of bodiness, okay? So if there were such a thing as time, it would be some sort of bodiness. So those who believe in time believe that they have to have some body identity. Have to. And, soon people start believing that they're animals, actually. They said, I woke up this morning and I just realized I thought I was a human being all this time, and now I realize I'm really a dog. I'm really a dog. I'm really a dog, yeah. And my gosh, Or I just realized I'm actually a simian, some sort of simian. Or a cat. And so they'll go in and start getting whiskers. They'll have whisker implants. They'll have whisker implants and change their eyes and start having, try to grow fur or something, or change the vocal cords so they can purr. I'm a cat now. I'm a cat lady now. And because it's the grass is always greener, because the idea of time starting really means that spirit, you don't have any identity. You wouldn't have any identity at all, actually. So... whatever identity you have, it never feels right. It never feels right. And so it gets very whimsical. Very whimsical. I saw these YouTube videos or something of a guy who thought he was a tiger, and he had all these hundreds of surgeries to change himself into a tiger. Eventually he committed suicide because he said even that, once he became a tiger, he says, that's still not it. That's still not it. We have spiritual delight in seeing this, and we're not putting anyone down, but there's a spiritual delight in seeing through how silly it is, right? There has to be. We can't take it seriously. If we take it seriously, then it's not silly. It must be true. So we have to laugh at the silliness of it, not laughing at anyone, because we've all been there and done that. Okay, but it's sort of a joy in saying, "Wow, this is quite a farce, isn't it?" We really have this grand farce taking place in the world right now, which is not being identified properly. Except we are doing that here. We are identifying it properly, but. In most of the world, in most places, 99.9999% of everything, they don't understand what's going on. They're just scratching their heads saying, something really weird is going on. What's happening here? Yeah, they think, well, there's just a cosmic alignment that's going to take place, and this is the line, and out of the center of the cosmos will come this, you know, this and this, and whatever, New Age ideologies, all sorts of beliefs, and time is finally going to start. They say, time is finally going to start. We've just been preparing for it up till now, but then finally it's going to start, and so they're all gearing up, say, okay, tomorrow time, I'm going to have to function as a, not a spirit, but as a body. So, and they say, I'm not quite ready to do that, and so it must be the body's fault. This body here is not quite the right body for me. I need another different type of body, you know. So if the man will say, maybe if I'm a woman, that will cure my problem. Maybe it'll cure my problem. So, and of course, in the back of their mind, they say, well, I've had this in the back of my mind for a long time. Well, sure, because if you believe time's going to start, you always feel that whatever body identity you have, it's not going to be good enough. You know, it's not going to work. And you need something different. You need something different. So, of course, they say, well, it's been in the back of my mind. This concern has been in the back of their minds, and in the back of everyone's mind who believes they need a body identity. Absolutely. It's always there. If believing that time is going to start, you're going to have these fears and these insecurities. And that's going to play out in society. So society is a bunch of time worshippers right now, actually. There's a whole lot of time worshippers. And they pray to the goddess of transformations, you know, the one who's able to put them through all sorts of transformations. He says, don't worry, I'll help give birth to a new identity for you, you know. And they just go into, you know, don't worry, I have all the clothes, all the surgery, all the drugs, all this, I can make you this new identity. And then these people are then held up as icons of what's hip, you know, like what works. So, gee, I feel so happy now. You know, I'm disregarding the fact that suicide is about 20 times higher for those who keep going through these go through these gender shifts or identity shifts. About 20 times higher suicide rate than the normal population. They keep saying, no, it's just because you don't accept me as I am. Well, you can accept them as they are till the cows come home. But as long as they believe time's going to start, they're never going to feel secure. Nobody is ever going to feel secure as long as they believe in time. It's impossible. And of course, they blame it on others, saying, wait a minute, you just don't accept me as I really am. You know, if you just did, I'd be happy. I'd feel secure. That is not true at all. It's not true at all. And they're demanding people, you know, yeah, you must, you're the problem. No, it's your belief in time is the problem. That's the problem. So don't let them push you around. Don't let them bully you. We don't need any body-based identity at all. Nothing in particular. Anything, whatever it is, doesn't matter, you see. So there's no reason we don't need to modify anything. We don't need to change anything. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And as we're laughing at this, we're laughing at ourselves too, because we all have some of this within us. We have some of this insecurity because we have not fully dropped this idiotic notion of time starting. And in order to do this, we need to begin to experience the miraculous. Now, some might say just hearing this is miraculous. They say, I never thought I'd ever hear this, you know, explanation like this. I've been looking for this explanation of why am I so weird? Why is everything so weird here? Why, you know, what's going on at the end times? I said, maybe I'll never understand this. I'm locked into this inability to comprehend what's happening. And then you hear something explanation, and then you just say, wow, where did that come from? You know, where did that come from? Yeah, you know, it's called a lot of work. It's called work, is where it came from. It's working all this through in order and managing, working. It came through working on managing success, and a long, long path of managing success. And then you're able to successfully entertain, you know, clarity, a clear perspective on what's happening here. And it even shocks me. I mean, I'm even shocked about this. It's the first time I've even seen this. It just, you know, it's coming out of me right now, because I know I'll be able to manage the success of this somehow, be able to, you know, just manage the wow of it. There's a big wow to it. It's like, because, you know, you realize, wait, you know, finally it's been put in perspective, and it just hasn't been put in perspective before here. It just isn't happening. I keep looking for, isn't there a no, there's none. So I say, well, I got to do it. You know, I got to do it. I'm not going to sit around waiting, just, you know, floundering. You know, I've had enough floundering. So I'm going to just say it. I'm just going to do it. So, you know, some level people are saying, wow. You know, that's really something. So I understand that there's a wow to this for sure. But I have a history. I'm used to this. I'm used to it to a certain extent. But this is a higher degree. Before, I would premiere major musical works in major cities in Europe, and it was a big wow for the population of Europe at that time. You know, wow, this is being premiered here, and then here, and then here, and then here in the major cities, and then people would say, oh my gosh, this is really something. You know, this is a, you know, this musical composition is quite a perspective. You know, it's quite a amazing perspective. And so it would wow people, and then people would say, yeah, you're the guy who is wowing us, you know. They'd say, I have a history of it. So I'm able to do this now, but this is a much bigger wow, because this is putting the whole existential, you know, the spiritual politics of the times into the right context. And that's a big wow. It's been very difficult, to say the least. I don't understand why it's been so difficult, but it has. And obviously, it's difficult for everybody, because it just, we're floundering. And, you know, there are those who are trying to do this, and this is part of the vibe here, you know. It's part of the vibe. So it's encouraging, because they're saying, wait a minute, you know, there's something very odd about all this. But that's about as far as they can go. They say, this isn't right. Why are we doing this? You know, why? What's going on? A lot of us are that way, right? More and more every day, we're saying, hey, you know, wait a minute. What's going on here? This is starting to get too strange. So we don't want to keep floundering, okay? We don't have to keep floundering. Why should we? We're spirit. I'm not a body. I'm free. Time's never going to start. So why should I be floundering in lack of recognition of what's going on? Don't have to. I don't want anybody to flounder, actually. See, that's my hope, that nobody flounders. We all come to the realization, oh wow, this is what we're doing. So I include everybody in that. So I'm not judgmental about anybody at all. I understand what's going on. All these people are acting out all these roles in various ways. They're floundering. They're desperate. They're frightened. They're severely frightened. They think the time's going to start. So if I thought the time would start, I'd be just doing the same. I'd be doing the same if I thought time was going to start. I put myself through it. I actually intentionally put myself through a lot of this to see what it's like, to see what it's like to flounder. So I can relate to it. I absolutely can relate to it. I knew that time wasn't going to start, but I said, well, what would it be like if you thought it did? What would it be like? And then you realize all this floundering takes place for sure. And I said, okay, so it's not a judgment on anyone, any spirit at all. It's a judgment on time, 100% on time. And that is the judgment that time doesn't exist and will never start. And this is the judgment that ultimately frees everyone from this floundering. You can only be free from this floundering when you recognize that time will never start. There's no such thing. So you don't need to worry about what kind of body identity, form-based identity you have. You don't have to worry about that. And so everyone will be ultimately safe from this folly that they're going through. And you know, there's no judgment here, really. Just, you know, forgive yourself for all the weirdness that you put yourself through. And it's just much ado about nothing, actually. It doesn't touch your identity at all. It doesn't bother your identity at all. It doesn't touch it. Controller to change the light levels did not pop up, so there's no way for me to change it. So I just have to live in the light now, I guess. There's no way around it. And again, in a previous life, I was friends with all these big shots, you know. And they say, you know such a, oh sure, I just had lunch with them yesterday. Or, of course, I know all these people. It's in the circle of these people who are, you know, cultural movers and shakers in terms of premiering all this cultural stuff. And then, so people think, wow, look at the circle of friends you have. You know, it's absolutely astonishing. You know, you know all the most important people, but in this lifetime, it's the spiritual friends that I've come to know. Okay, that's a higher sort of way higher situation. So I say, well, yeah, Jesus is my friend. Okay, Jesus is my friend. Longchenpa is my friend. These various teachers, they're my friends. Meaning, we share a common understanding. Share a common understanding. There's no such thing as time. They understand that perfectly. I'm still floundering to, you know, trying to come to that, you know, perfect realization. There's no such thing as time. Will never start. You know, still cleaning it out, still clearing out and cleaning up. They're already there. They're already there. So they're much better than I am. But I still can call them my friends because we do have a basic, common understanding agreement. That there's no such thing as time. We don't need to prepare for it, etc., etc. So when I say, yeah, Jesus is my friend, and people, what? You know, I have a history of being friends with very notable notables, very notable notables. And I understand that friendship is based on you hold common understanding, you know, understandings in common with somebody. Well, for instance, those who are doing all this weird stuff, they have lots of friends, right? And they say, well, see, you're my friend because you believe that time is going to start too. So you're my good friend because you're going to motivate me to keep searching for that identity I just can't seem to find, you know. And today my hair is going to be red. Tomorrow is going to be blue. You know, today I'm going to wear this dress. Tomorrow is this completely different ensemble. Today I'm listening to disco. Tomorrow I'm listening to acid rock. You know, and today I'm using this drug. Tomorrow I'm using that drug. And it just goes on and on and on. And they're friends with all these other people who are doing the same thing, freaking out, thinking time is about to start. So that's why they're friends. Now with me, I'm friends with those who are not freaking out, who realize time can never start, doesn't exist, will never exist. So those are my friends. Those are my friends. Those are what I feel comfortable with. And you can be friends with that too. You'll be part of the friendship, the overall friendship, sharing common understanding, sharing common understanding. Now, you could say a miracle happened yesterday with this practice that I've been starting now. It was a fabulous practice. So that's a miracle. Just to be able to assert to the world a different assertion to the world, saying, you know, tree released in the now, sky released in the now, road released in the now, leaves released in the now, people released in the now, all flesh released in the now, car released in the now released in the now, abstraction released in the now, concreteness released in the now. That was actually it first started out with just identifying. I was driving through, had to take a trip in California, and I was driving through this beautiful country, Marin County. I was driving through Marin County, actually, and through all the vineyards there, and it's just these beautiful land with, you know, just sort of flat with a little bit of hilly, just the way the land is beautiful. It's all covered with vineyards right now, and the vineyards are just luscious green right now. And I've never seen anything like it, actually. It's just gorgeous countryside, just gorgeous. It's just wow. And I just started saying, you know, when you say released in the now, meaning it's released from serving the purpose of trying to get you ready for time, and you release it to now helping you prepare for time not starting. Okay, before, you see this tree, the way I've been seeing this tree, I've been holding that image of a tree because it serves the purpose of preparing for time to start. Now I release that image of the tree, and now that released image serves the purpose of time not starting, preparing for time not to start. Okay, do you get that? So released in the now meaning time not starting. The now means time not starting. So the image of this tree, tree released in the now. I mean, I release the image of this tree, so now it serves the purpose of preparing for time not to start. Yeah. Vineyard released in the now. Vineyard released in the now. You know, fruit stand released in the now. So I was just telling everything that I saw as I'm driving along that you're now released. Okay, this image that I have, we're seeing just our own images. This is released. Okay, released into the now. It now serves the purpose of preparing for time not to start. So this is a very sophisticated practice, to say the least. And then this morning, it became even more elevated, where I began to work on duality and began to release all of duality into the now. Like light released in the now. Darkness, all darkness released in the now. All light released in the now. All wickedness released in the now. All righteousness released in the now. All concreteness released in the now. All abstraction released in the now. So I didn't just release, you know, one side of duality. I released both sides, the good and the bad and the ugly. All practicing, releasing all of that into the now. And that was very, very profound. Sadness released into the now. Happiness released into the now. Stupidity released into the now. Intelligence released into the now. Release everything you can think of into the now. All thoughts, good thoughts, bad thoughts, you know. Brilliance released into the now. Even now released into the now. Even God released into the now. Because what we're talking about is the concept, the image we have of God released in the now. Because we think we've been preparing for time to start, which means it would just be an image, our imagination. We're living in the image. So we've been living with all these images. So we've had an image of God, image of goodness, image of everything. But that's preparing us for time to start. Now we don't need any of that. We can release it into the now. Even perfection, we have an image of perfection, but perfection released into the now, imperfection released into the now. And this is just this assertion that was just, it was the practice, I was just naturally practicing this. I felt like easy for me to do this. Yeah, it was just, that was wow. Now, obviously, I realized this is a very, very advanced type of practice. So I'm like, wow, what's going to happen next? This is part of the success. Well, you know, you start practicing this way, and you realize you're really pulling up the roots of delusion. fast, you know, the whole plant's coming up. The roots released in the now. Dirt released in the now. So I'd see some field, you know, and there's dirt there, and I'd say, just dirt, you're released in the now. Dirt released in the now. dirt released in the now. This dirt is released from all images I held about it that were helping me prepare for the so-called start of time. You're released dirt. You're released in the now. You're released into the now. Okay, released tree, released into the now. Released in the now. Released into the now. Sky, released into the now. Sun, released into the now. Mountains, released into the now. Vegetation, released into the now. Space, released into the now. River, released into the now. Redwood trees, released into the now. Wind, released into the now. Heat, released into the now. Every facet of my experiencing, I tried to, whatever occurred to me, release it. As soon as it occurs to me, released into the now, released into the now. And so this is just extremely profound, and it does bring a wow feeling with it, for sure. But I was feeling very good about this practice while doing it. It was just tremendous. It seemed to help to be driving along through this countryside with all this varied looks to it, you know. Barn released into the now. Barn, you're now released into the nowness. I mean, released into serving me as helping me prepare for time not to start. That's what it means. You now are released into this new purpose. You've been given a new purpose. This is what this practice means. But you have to practice it. Don't just hear this conceptually and say, okay, I understand it now. No, it has to be practiced. You cannot get the true feeling of it, experiencing of it, unless you're actually practicing it. So just driving along and just practicing this. And it was quite extraordinary. Because I could feel like this is something, this is a happening. This is something really important. This is really something profound. Never done this before, right? Have you ever just driven along releasing everything from it, from all the purpose that it ever held for you? And that's what I was doing. I said, you know, grass, you know, released from the now, released into the now. Grass released, this is now grass released into the now. This is what I'm saying. Dirt, I'm seeing you as dirt released into the now. I'm not seeing you as the old dirt. I'm seeing you as the new dirt. I'm seeing you as dirt released into the now. I'm seeing you as grass released into the now. I'm seeing you tree as tree released into the now. As I'm just practicing this. Now, I didn't have any sort of, you know, bursts of light or anything. Nothing happened except I was feeling sort of this deep sense of success. It was very, very, this is very, very successful. And so I kept driving fine. 6 hours of driving yesterday, you know, I'm fine. Tired. It's tough driving these days in crowded, congested Bay Area, or anywhere in California, actually. Everybody is frantic. Everybody's frantically preparing for time to start. They're all driving like bats out of hell. You know, really. If you've ever seen bats coming out of hell, you know, this is how they drive in the Bay Area now. Pretty much so. Or bats coming out of a deep, dark, you know, there are these huge sinkholes, there's huge, you know, in around the world where bats live, can congregate. It's amazing, some of the stuff in the earth that we're, and deep down there, there's like some pool down there, bats come flying out of there in the evening time, just wow, you know, just zigging, zagging, and frantically, look so frantic, bats. So this is how they're starting to drive here, because the pressure is on them. See, this is the pressure. They're guzzling, and you know, guzzling high intensity stimulants, and they're revved up, you know, got their morning Starbucks coffee, which has got a ton of caffeine in it. Super strong coffee, actually. But there's a lot of strong coffee, a lot of strong people are hyped up because they're frantic. They're frantic. Some of them are pursuing success. And they said, my gosh, you know, I just don't have the right house. I don't have the right car. I don't have the right wardrobe. I don't have the right makeover. I don't have the right friends. I don't have the right, I haven't gone to the right places. I don't have the right amount of money. You know, what the heck am I going to do when time starts? So I'm going to be a mess. You know, this is their mindset. So I need a better gadget. I need a better smartphone. I need to find the right app. You know, I don't have the newest, maybe the newest iPhone will solve this problem for me. So, of course, these tech companies are preying on this insecurity. And they say, yeah. I said, don't worry. He said, we know the next model will have the answer for you. Don't worry about it. And it's coming out real soon. So we almost got it for you. And the people, you know, the techies, the junkies, tech junkies, they're like, they're waiting for the next fix. It's like heroin for them. They've got to have it. I know if I just get this newest upgrade, the newest phone, that's going to work for me. I'm going to have what I need. And it's a mania here. It's a world mania, actually. It's spread throughout the whole world. The whole millennials are like this, you know. And not just them. The world in general is caught up in this frenzy, thinking, it's almost here, so this next whatever is bound to be it. It's got to be it. Has to be it, right? By definition, if time's going to start, then by definition, I have to be ready, and therefore I have to get the right things have to be present for me to get ready. So this next upgrade has to be it. Has to be it. The next, you know, tablet or whatever. This is just whatever the Apple Watch or whatever. If I get this watch, that'll be it. You know, I'll have the right identity, and so when somehow be able to please time because I'm wearing the new iWatch or something. And the whole culture is built on this mania. It's a mania right now. Okay. Tech addicts, yeah. There's a severe addiction in the world right now. I've been in it since the very beginning, and eventually I realized, hey, this is crazy. This is not going to work. The Holy Spirit woke me up to the situation. I mean, Apple got founded just about in my backyard, you know, just right in this area, and this whole thing, you know, started personal computing, gadgetry, everything, and these people just, you know, they're just complete addicts. Got to have it. It has to be, by definition, by logic, right? They say, well, by logically, it has to be it. And then, of course, it never is, and they say, well, it's almost it, but the next one will be it. And then again, they get the next one, they say, okay, this is it. Then the graduates say, no, it's not quite it, but it's almost it, so the next one will be it. And they're just feeding this frenzy, you know, just milking this cow. Milking the cow of insecurity. Because, and so they can say that, well, yeah, I own this island, or, you know, that's it. See, I just don't have I just don't own a big enough island, or a yacht or something. Once I get that big yacht, that's it. That's going to be my identity. Finally, I have a time-based identity I can be happy with. And yet they're sitting on their big yacht, you know, and cruising somewhere. They're still thinking like, nah, this isn't quite it. I don't quite have it yet, you know. What's the next step? Got to figure it out, you know. This is exactly what's happening. It's hilarious. And some of them go guru shopping too. They say, I just don't have the right teacher. That's why I'm not. Maybe there's some teacher who can help me get ready for time. You know, it must be. Don't have the right yoga instructor. Not doing the right yoga asanas, you know. I just do this yoga asana, get my body to be this supple, you know, and get my body to breathe and de-stress. And when time starts, I'd be able to just go right into this yoga asana and I'll be, you know, be able to be with it, you know, and just like, oh, great. Able to align with time, able to function in time, how wonderful. Just have to have the right yoga instructor. The right music, the right food, the right lifestyle, you know. Lifestyle coaches. I need the right lifestyle coach. Coach. So it's good to have a good laugh at all this and see how silly it is. Absolutely how silly it is. It's very helpful. There has to be a levity to this, because really, in hindsight, we're going to have quite a chuckle about it. We might as well start chuckling right now. It's all our frantic antics to get ready for time, and all the while there's never going to be any start of time. No chance, no possibility of it ever. So all these antics, these hoops that we're dancing, jumping through all these hoops, you know, one day we'll look back and say, wow, that was pretty funny. That was pretty silly. Hilarious. And so we might as well start laughing at ourselves right now. Right, seeing the hindsight right now. Once you realize that time is never going to start, you automatically start having the hindsight. Like, what the heck have I been doing? You know, dreaming up these bodies, putting these bodies through all these antics, and thinking that this was what I absolutely needed. If I didn't have this, I was going to be annihilated, and all nothing but a complete farce. I had this one experience a while ago, and I mentioned in a video where my body identity just disappeared. And I realized, sitting on the bed, and I realized, where did my identity go? Yeah, it's just, wait a minute. My body, it wandered off somewhere. So I just kind of said, well, you know, it's no big deal. If it's gone, if it's lost, whatever, I'm not going to go chasing after it. It just wasn't there. Just somehow just wandered off. That hasn't happened since, but it was an experience, and I was fine with it. I said, oh, well, that's not a big deal. It's no big deal. Whatever. I'm not going to go chasing after it. I'm not going to get frantic. What happened to my body identity? You know, because that's what we think we need for time to start. We need that body identity. I wish it would wander off again, that's for sure. Maybe that's the miracle that can happen, that my body identity just wanders off. And people say, that's a terrible thing. How the heck are you going to function once time starts? You know, that's crazy. You'll go crazy. You won't know how to function. You need that body identity. You got to go find it. Let us help you find it. Say, it just wandered off from wherever. Wherever it wandered off to is fine with me. It doesn't really matter. But the ferocity of people in the world right now is coming to the surface, and you find out who has done their homework and who hasn't, actually. A lot of people who called themselves quote-unquote Christians, for instance, were really just pagans, just sort of, you know, their country adopted the religion, and they just went along with it, but they're not really Christians at all. The Christian is someone who takes up the challenge that Jesus gave us, which is really to recognize that there is no time. Time will never start. And take up therefore, we are equal with God. You know, there's no difference between us and God in terms of being formless spirit, perfectly free. We're not body identity at all. And take up the challenge of our spiritual cowardice. You know, we're really cowards. We're afraid to look at this truth. We're afraid to look at truth, so we're cowards. So Jesus, you know, is pointing out to us, hey, you're spiritual cowards, really. And you've got to take up the challenge, otherwise you're cowards. You continue in floundering in cowardry. So, you know, what does a real Christian do? Is every morning get up and face their cowardice. You know, face the cowardice and say, wow, I'm too scared to look at this. I'm too scared to profess this. I'm too scared. You know, Jesus said, if you know the truth and you don't proclaim it, then that's no good at all. You're still being a coward. So you're supposed to profess the truth. You're supposed to share the truth. You're supposed to say that, you know, that this is, and you're supposed to, you can't be a coward. So every day, for me, I get up every day. I realize, wow, it's another day. I've got to look into, why am I such a coward? You know, why do I still, you know, still afraid of truth and this? And then you have to then work on it during the daytime. This is what being a Christian is, for example, is all about. This is what any religion really is about, is facing your cowardice and just evaporating as much of it as you can, evaporating your fear as much as you can every day, and taking up the challenge of spiritual success. Taking up the challenge of spiritual managing your success. This is the challenge. As you go along, of course, you're going to have this challenge. And if you avoid that, then you're going to be sucked up in the belief that time is going to start, and you're going to be frantically trying to modify yourself in some way, and you're going to get caught up in that. And so this is why the society is crumbling, because there's quite a few in society who are just sort of nominal Christians, and they didn't really work at it. You know, you have to, the whole thing about religion, or for instance, is, for example, Christianity, you have to work at it every day. You have to face your cowardice every day. You have to face your continuity fear every day. To dissatisfy, to say, hey, you know, I still, you know, I'm still, something is wrong. I'm not. What is this? You know, let me look into this. And we're told, you know, it's not the body. You know, the quote-unquote body identity is not your problem. Okay, this is the fundamental challenge we have. Death of Jesus on the cross may have very well pointed this out to us. Is you can't use your body as an excuse. Okay, you cannot use, if you follow me, you can't use your body as an excuse. And I'll even discard my body just to show this to you. You cannot use your body as an excuse. In other words, you cannot say, wait a minute, if I just modified my body a certain way, then, because if you do that, you'll get caught up in this body modification stuff. Okay, so I practiced this. I said, okay, I'm going to see what happens if you light a fire here, what happens, knowing that probably this is what's going to happen. And so I know what happens is you get obsessed, you get caught up and obsessed with changing how you look, changing. And the obsession becomes worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. It's a downhill, it's a negative spiral, and you spiral into all the stuff that people are into right now. Anybody can spiral into that if they drop the challenge that real religion gives to us, that you can't use your body as an excuse. That's not the problem. All politics is spiritual politics. Our problem is spiritual. 100% is we believe that time will start. We must realize that time is non-existent. We've just arrogantly invented it, but it's just a figment of our own arrogance. That's all. We'll never start. And so that's the problem we have now, is we have this issue of continuity fear, and we've got to now, instead of preparing for time to start, prepare for time not to start. Okay, and this is the challenge we have. And you just look at people, and as you drive along, you can see how intensely they're into it, right? I mean, more and more people I'm seeing now is the hair, you know, dealing with their hair. That's been going through, you know, the hair often tips it off, you know, what people are into, right? But, you know, different colors, coloring it this, coloring it that, coloring that. And tattoos are also another way. Body modification tattoos. So I've got to stamp myself somehow. This body needs to be stamped with, like, I love time. You know, basically tattoos are saying, I love time. And I think if I just have this advertising how much I love time, then I'll be ready for time to start. And just how people are focused on their bodies now, right? They're so focused on their bodies. It's an obsession. It's a worldwide obsession. For me, I know that's not it. That never will work. It will never work. So I just, at this point, just shrug it off. You know, it just said, there's no interest. It doesn't work. It doesn't. It'll never work. It's the false path. It's the false path. So that's why in religion, oftentimes they emphasize, you know, drab dress. It don't modify your body. Just keep it simple. If you got long hair, just, you know, tighten a ponytail, and that's it. Otherwise, just have short hair and just leave it at that. You don't color your hair in any way. You don't mess with your hair. You wear, you know, clothing that just de-emphasizes the body. You know, you don't try any to attract any attention to the body. You say the body identity is not my problem. I don't need to struggle with it. It's the continuity fear that I have is the problem. So there's a spiritual problem I have. That's why modesty, body modesty is so important on the spiritual path. Otherwise, you will get sucked into thinking that the body is the problem. It's just I don't have the body; just isn't looking quite right today. It's if I could just wear a different pair of shoes. Absolutely. I said, wait a minute. Let me put this clothing on. Okay, is that a, so? You spend an hour or two in front of the mirror. Right? And if it gets real bad, you'll spend all day in front of them. You're saying, wait a minute. And you'll have, you know, try a thousand, you know, 100 different outfits and saying, is this it? 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 And it's still the insecurities there. And so then, of course, people then pay designers, you know, to the designer. Designers make their money by telling people, hey, look, you know, I know what works. And if you're wearing one of my concoctions, you know, it will work for you. It will work for you. Really? How much? Well, it's already expensive. That's okay. It's okay. It's okay. I somehow, you know, get the money here. And so they pay these tons of money for these, you know, fanciful fashion. And they think that they're wearing it, you know, and then they show up and say, you know, my designer told me this is it, and so who am I to say it's not it? And then they think that this is it, and they go around parading around, showing off, you know, that this is it. And other people look at them, and those who can project this is itness are called celebrities. That's why they're celebrities. They're saying, I know what's it. And then if you really get it under their skin, they don't have a clue what's it. But they say, yeah, but I know somebody who does know what's it. It's this designer who knows what's it. And you go to the designer and say, do you know what's it? And the designer says, no, I'm just, you know, they want to hear that. So I'm telling them that, you know, I don't know what's it. Nobody knows what's it. But we play this charade, you know. The celebrities say, oh, yeah, I know what's it. You know, I go to the right gym. I do the right exercises. I get to have the right styles and fashions. And I'm in the right, go to the right places. I meet the right people. And you know, and then all these, you know, the paparazzi media is taking all these pictures of the people who are saying, I know what's it. I know what's it. Just go watch this movie. You'll know what's it. You get the answers there. Just go see this new movie. And people are just complete suckers for all this. We're absolute suckers for it. We can't help it. As long as we believe that time is going to start, we'll be suckers for all of this stuff. And it's really hellish. It's really hellish. I mean, it's not fun at all, actually. This is what I discovered. It's not fun. It's not fun. It's a compulsion. It's fearful. It's fearful. Because at the end of the day, you go home and you realize it was not really it at all. And I put all this effort and, you know, intense belief and effort in it. And I know I'm just fooling myself. It's not really it. And I need to, you know, I think my jaw is not quite right. You know, I look at this profile like this and like this. And my features are just, if my features were just tweaked a little bit, you know, that'd probably be it. Maybe I better go see a plastic surgeon. Because I've got, I think my nose is, you know, it somehow seems to distort, you know, the rightness of me. You know, it must be my nose. You know, it must be this. It must be this. I'm not wearing the right accessories. I don't have the right accessories. Probably my accessories. That's not it. So you have this massive materialism in this world, all fueling, feeding this insecurity that we have, believing that time's going to start. Massive insecurity. And of course, though, the economy runs on this. And so the economy says, whoa, we got to keep this going, or else the economy's going to collapse if we do. So they say, you got to keep believing in this the time, otherwise the whole economy's going to collapse, which isn't, it would be downsized. That doesn't mean it would collapse, actually. We just don't need all this stuff. At all. We don't really need it at all. They can make shirts that, like a good linen shirt, real hardy linen type of shirt. Yeah, the shirt lasts, you know, 30 years or more. Or they can put buttons and sew them on. You can have the same shirt for 30, 40 years, even your whole life. Just have a couple of shirts and a couple of pants, some sandals, and that's it. Just a couple of shoes and you know, that's it. Don't even worry about fashion. Don't even worry about it. Fashion is just insecurity, severe insecurity. And so is anti-fashion. It's like saying, hey, anti-fashion is it. That's insecurity too. You could tell the difference, right? You know, the anti-fashion sign. Someone says, oh, okay, I'm going to shave my head. I'm going to stop wearing shirts altogether, go bare-chested, shave my head, and wear these yoga pants, and I'm going to get real tan and sit here and do those yoga saunas and say, look, I'm not interested in my body identity or anything, but they are still obsessed with it. They're still obsessed with it. And so, of course, we're all, to some extent, nervous about it. Okay, so just don't crack on yourself too hard, but just keep trending in the right direction, trending in the right direction. Just let yourself, let the body just be basic. Okay, just basic blah, just blah. I know there's something always pestering me. You got to get in better shape. You got to get in better shape. My gosh, come on. I said, you know, start running, start doing. I said, well, why? Wait a minute, why? Well, you're out of shape. I said, yeah, well, so what? Well, you got to get in better shape. Well, I know what it's about. I said, well, I got all these clothes, and you can't fit into these clothes, or you got to get more stylish. You got to look good. I said, why? Why are you so obsessed with looking good? Well, don't you know time is about ready to start? Are you going to be ready for that? And I say, forget it. I'm gonna go tape and share the gospel with everyone. I'm not gonna get into frantic exercising. But there's this really big push right now for exercising. This is part of the whole thing. This area, exercise studios are popping up like mushrooms here, all over the place. It's a mania. And people are frantic. They need to get in shape. They feel I need to be like some, you know, super body because time's about ready to start. And only if I have this body is really fit am I going to be able to hit the ground running. You know, they think I got to hit the ground running as a body. So got to be in great shape. And this is what's driving, fueling all this stuff. It's amazing. I mean, you talk about miracles. Miracles can be very subtle. Holy Spirit can be very subtle. It just certain things have been happening lately. Just where some information just comes to me, and somebody just walking past me, and walking past, I happen to be talking with somebody who was setting up a exercise studio, and someone walked by, and I said, wow, it's going to be very competitive. I think this area of exercise studios is very competitive. And he says, oh, yeah. He says, hey, there's all sorts of these studios popping everywhere. I know one here and here and here and here and here. And he knew all the various exercise studios. I didn't know that, but it just, he says, they're just so many popping up everywhere now. And he said, this is the mania. He's a young person, so he knows. He's in tune with the younger people. He said, it's a mania. Just because the mania now is the belief that time is going to start. You know, this whole belief of the world is end times, is a belief that our cycle of preparation is going to come to an end, and then time is going to start. Okay, this is what many believe, subconsciously or consciously, whatever you want to put. And there's not an ounce of truth to that whatsoever. Not any truth to that whatsoever. Time can never start. It would mean that we'd have to change fundamental nature of reality, and that cannot happen. God's will cannot be changed. So we only have perfect freedom. We don't have time. So there isn't going to be any start of time. There isn't going to be any millennia where time has started and the fortunate ones are prepared are going to be able to function in there. That's never going to happen. What's going to happen is you have those who believe that time is going to start continue to pound the drums for this and create some sort of super celebratory situation where they think the reason why time hasn't started is because we haven't adopted this celebratory attitude towards it as if it's going to start. So they kind of twist this powerful mental practice of practicing alreadyness. Yes, I already know that there's no such thing as time, which is the right use of this. They twist it and say, yes, I already know that time has already started, and they're going to have this new world religion, which is going to be based on asserting and affirming that time has already started, as if doing that will somehow get it started, you know. And so you might have this 1,000 years of freak out like this or something where they go through this exercise in futility. But that's where the world, that's where things, where things are headed. But there's other things that are going to intervene, and most likely. So this is the trouble. The pressure is just becoming absolutely maniacal. And that if you don't adapt this attitude of I need to have all options open, you know, then you're some, you know, terrible person who's trying to prevent time from starting. as if how can you prevent something that doesn't exist from existing? How is that possible? Time doesn't exist, so how can it start? So therefore, how, if it can't start because it doesn't exist, how can you stop it, prevent it from starting? It's just completely illogical. Totally illogical. The only way that their logic makes any sense is the premise that time does exist and it absolutely will start. That's the only way. If you don't have that basic premise, then everything they're doing is just, you know, it's ridiculous. It's just ridiculous. But their ideology is ridiculous. And this is the divide between the sheep and the goats in the world right now, which we're told the end times, the wheat and the tares, as Jesus spoke about it. Is that at this end times you'll have the divide between the goats who want to keep on intensifying their practice, thinking that if they do that, this time will certainly start for them. Those are the goats, which are eat anything goats, you know, anything goes. This is the anything goes of the starting in the 60s, anything goes. The sex, drugs, and rock and roll crowd, anything goes. Those are the goats who believe that is the best, that's how time will start, is we're willing to go in any direction with time. However time wants us to, whatever body identity time wants us to have, we'll have it. You know, if we want to be half lion, half human, or half bull, half human, or if we want to, like, time asks us to tear ourselves apart, we'll do it. You know, whatever time says, we want to be able to have all options open. And therefore, this mentality, you know, demonizes those who say, no. Don't work on any of that stuff. Just keep it simple. Just accept whatever, you know, whatever your birth is like, whatever the situation about, you know, the body or like, just let it be as it is. Don't pursue any other options at all. Restrict this entire notion of I need to pursue body identity options. Restrict it all, so you don't get waylaid into this delusion of that time is going to start. This mania. Those are called religious restrictions. Put crucify your quote unquote passions, as they say it, which is really crucify your belief in time, and crucify the all of the temptations to get into this anything goes mode. And of course, those who believe that time will start feel that they're being persecuted. This persecutes them. It doesn't allow them to prepare for what they think is inevitable. And of course, they're just completely deluded. So you truth and lies are not both true. Okay, only truth is true. So those who know what is true, they're not persecuting those who are following a lie. They're telling them that, you know, this is futile. It's futile. And they have every right to point this out. Say, this is futile for you. And you have no choice but to drop this nonsense. I know the pressure is just insanely intense because I was put under all this pressure of what the goddess put me under this pressure. She said, you got to set up all these great celebration situations. And we'll have massive amount of costume changes. Everybody will be changing clothes all the time, and different. So he's really trying to build up this huge floating celebration to welcome what time, the start of time. It was never put to me that way, but now I recognize that's exactly what it was all about. And the whole idea was we just have this grand, massive ball masquerade, you know, like the aristocrats used to have with had the money, that everybody in society will get caught up in this, and we'll just be constantly changing clothes with everybody, you know, changing our looks constantly. Now I'm look this way, wearing wigs, you know, different glasses, just completely costuming out, constantly costuming out in different ways, listening to different music in all ways, all sorts of different foods in all ways, and then of course that eventually goes into all sorts of drugs and promiscuity and all this stuff. It doesn't seem to start that way, but it inevitably, that's how it goes. Because it doesn't work, all this costuming doesn't work. So there's this huge worldwide attempt that there's this goddess who's behind this. This is an archetypal. This is our own arrogance advising us in marketing this to us. So how we market it to ourselves? Who's absolutely marketing all this? And I was very clearly instructed in how to go about it, and to set up all these worldwide centers that could serve as celebration areas, and just like in the 60s, the vast celebration, the pagans celebrating like Golden Gate Park, you know, and they're just their freak outs and just everybody dancing and tripping and costuming and, you know, just all this stuff. That was the idea, is to have this on a global scale, but way more intense, way more sophisticated. And that's the goal of the goddess, actually. And she's pursuing that goal intensely. And of course, she insists that these be a tinge of spirituality. After all, we're welcoming the new divine. Time is the new God, you know. So we got to have all the spirituality about it too. We have to say how to pray to the new God of time. We have to know how to worship the new God of time. We have to know how to celebrate the new God of time in spiritual song and festivities. We have a new calendar with all these festivities, worshiping the God of time. There's an entire new world religion that is being birthed right now, and there is this. There is this archetype, which is our own imagination, in the form of this goddess, that is in charge of hosting the celebration. She's the hostess of it, and she's going to host time. She's the one who's going to enable time to start here. And they put it like, well, time needs to start on this planet. It started other places, it just hasn't reached this planet yet. Because, well, why? Well, it's got to travel through space. It takes a while for time to get here. So this planet is now ready to host time, for time to start here. And so the goddess says, I'm the hostess who understands what time really wants. How can we make time feel comfortable here? How are you going to feel comfortable with time? She says, I know how to get you comfortable with time. So I need to have this continual celebration of sex, drugs, rock and roll, so to speak, of you know, in the 60s, and it was happening right in the Bay Area and around the world, big cities, just, you know, especially in San Francisco, it was like the very center of it. So people would go to these acid tests, these freakouts at various ballrooms and stuff, and with all the color lights and people, everybody was completely tripping, and everybody was costumed. You know, you go to thrift stores and you just buy. That's a big part of this thing, celebration. You're supposed to have like a massive wardrobe of clothes. I said, how can I even afford that? I said, thrift stores, antique stores. You know, so, you know, I became an expert in shopping in those stores, so I could advise people, this is how you can get all these costumes and clothes, you know. And you know, and then the whole thing of just altering your appearance, your physicality, altering it to be able to feel like you're fitting in with the new regime of time, the new divinity. And so the goddess is like the muse of time, the muse of time. How are you going to be comfortable under the new regime of time? And so this is not a joke. I mean, I received very detailed instructions of how to set this whole thing up. And others, of course, are also getting instructions. And you see it throughout all entertainment, throughout all of society. You see many who are following the instructions of the goddess. I can easily see, you know, what they're doing, because I was given the same type of instructions. I understand the basic game plan. And it's really to welcome time to this planet. And of course, time doesn't exist. So they'll be ambassadors of time show up here. from other planets saying, "Oh yes, on our planet, time has existed for a long time, and it's about ready to happen here. That's why we're here, because we're going to help you globally adapt to time once it starts here. So you're going to have these extraterrestrials come out of the woodwork very soon, actually, and those who are preparing for time will worship them and celebrate their arrival here." It's like they say that this is the greatest thing that's ever happened. We have ambassadors of time coming from other places in the cosmos where time has actually started, now arriving on this planet because time is about to start, or it has started, and they know how to organize everything on this planet so it's in alignment with time, and so we can function in time. What a blessing. They'll call that a great miracle, the great breakthrough here. And so they're all preparing for this huge global celebrations and parties and all this kind of stuff to welcome time to this planet. And I can say that all that preparation, it wasn't very much fun at all, actually. It was stress. It was fear. It was stress. It's feeling like, what? It doesn't work, you know. And in none of that stuff was there right spiritual practice taking place. In none of that stuff was there right clarity taking place. It was all about prepare more finery, flowers, music, costumes, everything. Massive amount of flowers are being prepared, the idea of flowers, and all sorts of beautiful arrangements and stuff that you have to somehow, decorate. Have these celebrations that are just like off the charts with all this celebratory feeling. The idea is to get you into this mood of all hail, the arrival of the ambassadors of time. We're so thrilled that you're here. And, like the big festivals they have in pagan festivals and ancient times too. Oftentimes, a massive amount of costuming, massive amount of flowers. What's festival like in Rio and stuff like that? That's an example. Massive amount of body adornment, costumes, and flower arrangements, all sorts of things, and music, etc. All this is we're being taught to get in this festive mood because time is about to arrive here. And not only that, but the ambassadors of time who know how to form a civilization that functions properly with time. Pretty amazing stuff, isn't it? But it's all true. It's absolutely what's happening. And of course, men are the knuckleheads as they're preparing for time. They're like they're the ones because they're used to being just wear this shirt, tie, and jacket, and I'm Mr. Businessman and I'm Mr. Conservative, and this is how I look and stuff. And the ladies are ones that are naturals at costuming. Says no, you can change your go down to the beauty salon. Come on, get work. You can change this. You need more ornamentation. I can do this. I can do that. And so they take the lead at this time as the world's getting ready to so-called. Celebrate the arrival of time here. The ladies are large and in charge, because they're much more comfortable with, the physicality of wearing different dresses, looks, changing their hairstyle, changing their hair color, makeup, ornamentation, even dancing, and all this stuff. It's even from the 60s. The women are always. They're the ones who led the whole thing, and they showed the men, this is how, to celebrate the arrival of, pagan festivities. This is how to do it, let your hair down, come on, dance, and get into your body, and they always said, men, you're so uptight, so uptight, how are you going to welcome time when you're so conservative, and you're so, you just want to, be more, no, don't want to emphasize any change, and they said, well, what's the matter, you're uptight, you're a square, you're a square, come on, Shake it. Shake your body. Get loose. Loosen up. Loosen up. Why are you so uptight? Loosen up. Loosen up. Loosen up. Let's do some body work here. Let's do more body work. You know, let's start painting our bodies. Oh, yeah. We can go with body painting. Oh, wonderful. You know, let's put some flowers in our hair. You know, oh, yeah, that's where it's at. And let's put some embroidery in our, come on, guys. Where's your embroidered shirt? Where's your embroidered shirt? You know, put some flowers in your clothing. Loosen up. Loosen up. Loosen up. Time is about ready to arrive here. You got to be very flexible when time arrives. So this is the relentless pressure that society was put under. And again, it's just a matter of historical record and fact that the women, you know, took the lead as we in the 60s, as we started to the world started to prepare for the belief that time is about ready to start here, and how to get into your body, how to function as a body. And the men were still saying, wait a minute, didn't Jesus tell us not to pursue vanity and crucify the lusts of the flesh, crucify the flesh? All this vanity and worldliness, didn't Saint Francis throw all that stuff in the street and go live as a monk and a hermit? Isn't that the ideal role that we're, isn't San Francisco named after Saint Francis? And Saint Francis was a time worshiper in his early years, and then he said, oh, wait a minute, you know, this is all wrong. Same with the Saint Augustine. Many of the great saints in history of Christianity were very worldly, and then they saw through it and said, whoa, this is a farce. This is actually worshiping time. Okay. It's worshiping the devil, Satan, time. Belief in time is the devil, so to speak. And then they threw it all away, and they adopted poverty and chastity. And even the Buddha was that way. Buddha was a hedonist up till the age of, 30-something, right? He was a prince. He's absolute hedonist. You know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll for the Buddha. And then he recognized, hey, wait a minute, you know, this doesn't have the answer I'm looking for. This isn't going to provide me the answers. And then he just, you know, flipped the switch and said, that's it. I'm leaving all this behind. So men have been said, this is the role models you need to follow. So men were very much focused on trying to remain, you know, conservative with their body identity, right? And insisting that the women also be conservative with that body identity. And you know, this is how society was. And then there's this severe rebellion when we got the birth control pill. Women said, hey, you know, forget it. We're going for it. We're going for it. You know, to heck with squares. You know, we want to swing. We want to be swingers here. Let's let our hair down and boogie here. And that's what happened. And the men were like shocked. They said, what in the heck is this? Absolutely. I can tell you by living through that time, that's exactly what happened. You know, hey, meet the Beatles, ladies, meet the Beatles. Yeah, 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 hey, I want to hold your hand. Let, you know, twist and shout. Twist and shout. And the women just started screaming like banshees, you know, like banshees. Absolutely. The whole thing, way to shake off the conservatism for them was to start screaming. So they just absolutely have these screaming contests, like, grabbing their hair, pulling their clothes, dancing, twisting, screaming, you know, just says, I got to shake off this reserve that I have, you know, and sitting in church that we've developed for thousands of years of discipline reserve. I've got to get free of that, because once time starts, I won't know how to function, you see, won't know how to function. And then all the drugs came in to help everybody, you know, loosen up from their so-called straightness. Being straight was a sin at that point. And this continues on to this day, where really the target of all this social engineering is Christians, or religious people in general. But most of the, you know, Christians are held up as the symbol of this restraint, self-restraint. Self-restraint, restrain the flesh. Be very, extremely modest in your body actions. You know, you don't dance, you don't gamble, you don't drink, you don't costume, you don't, you know, your vanity is severely restricted, your speech is has to be very clean and doesn't allude to the body, and you know, you have to avoid the pleasures of the flesh. You say no to that. You know, you have to be very, very much a Puritan. And so this is the reserve, the very important reserve that the world had built up. Very important reserve. And what happened was this notion that time is getting ready to start crept into the world, and a tiny mad idea crept into the world that it's about ready to start. And so people just started getting really nervous and started saying, hey, I need to rock, you know, freak out. I need to rock out. I need to completely shake myself free from all that reserve. I need to start screaming. I need to start raving. You know, this is all where it's all come from. This is entirely based on the belief in time, belief that time is going to start, that we need a body identity, and we need somehow to experience our freedom through a body identity. See, this is the notion of anything goes, is we think that will be a body, you know, permanently. This is our new identity, and once time starts, this will be our identity. And yet, but the way we can be happy, the way we can experience freedom within time, is just anything goes situation with the body. You know, I can dress any way I want to dress. I can do anything I want to do. You know, whatever. This is all, again, based on the belief in time. The time is going to start, finally start. And it was really as a freak out reaction, because actually what was happening in the world is we were starting to get close to realizing there's no such thing as time, and it's never going to start. And we realized that Jesus is returning. We realized he's going to return back then. We realized it's very soon he's going to return, and we better get ready for the end of the world, meaning no more body identity, no more need for a world. We're going to have a heavenly spiritual identity, and we're going to realize that's our only true identity. So we were getting ready for that, and then that this caused us a backlash, because we didn't manage our success properly. We started freaking out and getting nervous, saying, whoa, wait a minute, I'm not quite ready for that. I have a continuity problem. And then it started creeping into our minds that this notion of, hey, time is about ready to start, so I need to get ready for that. So there's this conflict, you know, what do we get ready for? To realize that time doesn't exist, or to get ready for the start of time? And so this is this cultural divide in the world right now. This is a cultural divide. So I looked at the entire situation and recognized, you know, what's really happening, and saying, you know, saying time doesn't exist. It will never start. That's the answer. That's the answer. So forget about the trying to prepare for time to start. That's not the way. It's not the way. It'll never be the way. Doesn't matter what you do. Doesn't matter which goddess you worship, which muse you worship to inspire you to modify yourself in some other way, which you think is like extraordinarily beautiful or appropriate or fanciful, or it'll catch the eye of time somehow. Doesn't matter how much you do that. You can do that now and unto forever, and it'll never ever result in your feeling of security, feeling of rightness. It will never cause time to start. You'll just be faced with the next modification and the dread of, like, this doesn't work. This doesn't work. This doesn't work. What can I do next? Yeah. I've put on, you know, 10,000 different pairs of sunglasses. And I'm wearing, you know, 100 strands of beads, and I've worn thousands of different strands of beads, and I'm dripping with accessories, and I'm this like a idol of, you know, like a goddess idol, where I've got bangles everywhere, and I'm wearing 10 headdresses, and all this stuff, and I still feel this isn't it, and I'm draped with garlands of flowers, and this isn't it. and I'm surrounded by flowers and fruits, and I'm listening to this music, you know, sacred music, and I'm in the right asana here, and you know, and I'm thinking, gosh, this whole thing is just being ruined by these sunglasses I'm wearing. I'm just not wearing the right sunglasses, or I just don't have the right accessory. If I just change that, you know, it's going to work. And then something creeps up in your mind that says, isn't that what I've always thought all along? That if I just change this one thing, it's going to work. Isn't that the exact same belief that I've been having? Hasn't that failed a million times? So why do I think if I just change the sunglasses I'm wearing, suddenly I'm going to feel ready for time? And then this dread starts to arise in you. And you start shaking. You just say, wow, this is too intense. This is so too intense. What if this doesn't work? And then finally you reach for those sunglasses one more time and change the sunglasses and put them on. And look at yourself. Is this it? For a moment you think it might be. And yet you still feel it. Then suddenly this insecurity is still there. You say, oh my God, it's not it. I said, maybe I need to change the goddess look entirely here. Maybe I'm not wearing the right sari or the right sandals. I need to get, you know, better designer shoes or something, right? I just don't have the right designer, that's why. Oh my gosh, I better hurry up and, you know, or I don't have the right embroidery. It's not quite right. This is what happens. You get into this because, you know, time doesn't start, and the more you try to prepare yourself for it to start, the more convinced you are it's going to start, and you don't feel ready. You get into this terrible cycle of time is almost ready to start, has to be, I'm all ready for it, and yet I still don't feel quite prepared. And to become more and more frantic to prepare for it, the more you prepare for it, the more you believe it's about ready to start, and the more pressure there is upon you like this. It's like that. It's a terrible cycle to go through, and the world is cycling into this way. I just need to be more fit, you know, the fitness craze. I gotta hit the ground running. So once time starts, you know, I probably will have to cycle around the world or something. I don't know, yeah, but I'm doing my 50 miles a day of cycling. So I should, maybe I'm ready. I don't know. I just gotta work out a little more. Time will want to, we'll give tests, you know, of our loyalty. So we think that time will say, okay, you got to prove your loyalty to time, and you got to prove you love time. So you got to do all this physical stuff. Maybe climb some mountain and plant a flag up there and do a yoga posture up there and say, yes, time, I'm so happy you're here for now, finally. And, you know, all of this is the subconscious driving everybody here. For me, I brought it up consciously, I did it consciously and purposefully to see what is it like to prepare for time. What's that like? And then I found out this is what it's like. And I said, okay, now I know what it's like. Okay, that's enough. Now let's get back. You know, let's get to the work of doing right spiritual practice and prepare for time not to start. That's the real preparation here. We have to do is prepare for time not to start. 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 Now there's the NBA finals has started, but we're busy here preparing for time not to start. You know, so I'm not watching it at this point. Even though my team is in the finals, the Golden State Warriors, haven't been there for 40 years. 40 years of hell. Been through 40 years of hell with that team. Most dysfunctional franchise in any sport history, I think, as you could say, the most dysfunctional franchise. It's just been an absolute embarrassment. But now, suddenly, they're winners again. I guess they've figured out a way to prepare for time. So they're going to try to be winners, you know. Winners. I can say, oh, we're a winner. Our team's a winner. And that doesn't help either. If your team wins, it doesn't help. We've had plenty of winners in the Bay Area here. From the Oakland Raiders and the Oakland A's winning world championships in the 70s, 80s, and the San Francisco Giants winning in the 2000s now, and now the Warriors are about, you know, trying to win. They might win, and so you get all these 49ers football team won in, of course, the 80s and the 90s, five Super Bowls, and so you get all these winners. It's never enough. It's never enough. It's never enough. You see, you feel like, wow, I'm still not quite ready for time to start. And of course, we're supposed to have a social conscience to help others get ready for time to start. That's why the goddess hooks you and says, don't you want to help others? Don't you want to help them get ready too? And she says, I know you're ready, but the others, they're not ready yet. You know, you got to help them get ready. And you got to help them get with, you know, the celebrations for time to start. But then I re-examined the whole thing. I said, wait a minute. That's not the way. That's not the way of spiritual success. That's trying to get ready for time. That's not getting ready for time not to start. That's what we really need to do. And that is actually sitting quietly, humbly, modestly. We can knock off the flowers here, actually. We can knock off the flowers. But can we knock off the flowers. There you go. Get rid of the flowers. And, of course, no music. So no flowers, no music, no dancing. No costuming. Just blah, monotone, bland clothing. That's it. No accessory. No, all these beads and accessories, makeup, all this stuff. No hair styling, you know, no styling, this, but no styling, okay? And of course, no, you know, anti-styling, which is just a dualistic counterpart of styling, you know, where you're saying, look at me, I'm so immaculately not styling. That's just bland, just blah, you know, a little bit of style, you know, just so you're not saying, hey, look at me, I'm not styling at all, but just bland, blah. No flowers, no music, none of this nonsense. Just your attention, just your willingness to manage your success. Willingness to manage your success. Write affirmation, full stop in the wow, flipping the script. Three-part practice. I can even get this out. Can I get this out of the picture? Somehow. Yeah, let me get that out of the picture. And get this out of the picture. All right. There you go. And there's still a leaf in the picture. That's okay. This one? Something doesn't matter. All right. So yeah, you know, we don't have to be obsessive about it at all. Just clear the decks. Welcome back. Jesus celebration is a different celebration than the goddess. Of course, the goddess is so arrogant. She says, no, I know how to welcome back Jesus too. It's the same thing as welcoming time, actually, because she thinks that Jesus is coming back here to start time. He's the one that's able to start time. This is what many have hoped for. You know, who didn't, the goats, who didn't understand what Jesus really came for. They think he's coming back here to start time. So the goddess says, oh, I know how to welcome Jesus back. Yeah, I know how to celebration. Just the same thing we do, you know, to welcome the start of time. That's what's going to happen. So that's what, you know, let's get the music and the flowers and the costuming and the dancing and the revelry going. And she's convinced that she knows how to welcome Jesus back. She's absolutely verklempt, you know, crazy. Doesn't know how to welcome Jesus back at all. So, it's those who are able to be conservative, to be modest, like, you know, restrain in speech and mind and body movement and action and all this restraint. Those are the ones that can welcome Jesus back. Now, is this a male thing? No. Women can also do this. You know, women can be very good at this too. Okay. Now, men have been working on this for a long time, so they also can be very good at this. The notion that somehow women are going to be way better at this than men is nonsense. You see, that's worshiping time back. Women seem way better at this because of their long history of costuming and makeup and adornment and all this kind of, you know, their hair, for instance. They have a million different hairstyles throughout history, always changing the look of their hair and stuff like that. So, you know, they're certainly superior when it comes to setting up, trying to set up a culture ready to worship time. They're certainly better at that. They aren't better, though, at worshiping Jesus back. They're not better. They can be equal, but they can't be better at it, really. There's no standoutness that you can reach, you know, in terms of modesty. There's no standoutness. You're just, you know, just blah. And just, you know, how can you stand out that way? Really, you can't, right? So you can't. There isn't this dichotomy between male and female in the true spiritual path. There really isn't that severe dichotomy. Whereas the pagan who are worshiping, who are setting up celebrations to worship time, the start of time, there is that dichotomy where women seem to be much more adept at that. And that's why a lot of men are desperately trying to become women, is they think, how in the world can I really be superior to, you know, I want to feel superior. And so the only way I can do that is be a woman, because they're so adept at costuming, hair modification, appearance modification. I mean, they're fabulous at that. No doubt about it. Their models can project this. This is it. So no matter what they wear, it looks good. It looks like, oh, this is it. This is it. It's like this confidence, like, whatever I wear, this is it. This is how, what time is going to like. This is it. So what you really want to be is that old, crusty, you know, white male, conservative, blah, you know, like that, to welcome back Jesus. That's what Jesus is looking for. And women can do that. There I've seen many women, are humble, modest, and are not going with this whole thing about time. So that's the way to go. But and realize then, it's not, you know, you cannot, would not be able to dominate the men the way that women are doing in this time celebration thing, how they're dominating men so severely. That doesn't play with welcoming back truth, Jesus, the truth that there's no such thing as time. The success doesn't come in dominating. The success comes in practicing affirmation. And the spiritual practice we have, affirmation, full stop, and the wow, flipping the script, is actually practicing it. Not being a model for modesty. Look, I'm a perfect model for modesty. That doesn't work, because the modesty, part of the modesty is actually practicing. Because then you're really getting it done. That's the success, is practicing. So, you know, tree released in the now. 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 House released in the now. Sidewalk released in the now. Telephone pole released in the now. All telephone poles, you are released into the now. See, costuming doesn't matter for this, does it? Hair color doesn't matter. Hairstyle doesn't matter, does it? This is right spiritual assertion. And yoga posture doesn't matter. Your weight doesn't matter. How you look doesn't matter. It's accepting this that matters in your mind, in your spirit. That's what matters. Where is that palm front coming from? I can't figure that out. Let me see. This? I don't know. That's a mystery. Can I resolve this mystery? Maybe I did. Okay. Just have a little bit there. You know, a lot of religious aesthetics, like men don't do any gardening, any grooming at all. They do it, they're all their beards grow, their hair go. They don't groom so much. They're, you know, there's very little grooming. They don't pay attention to how their body looks. It doesn't matter. Now, it seems as though most women are more attuned to grooming, good grooming and habits, etc., like that. So, you know, there's a little difference there for sure. Partly to it's a cleanliness thing for make sure their children don't get sick. You know, it's the idea of let's keep everything real neat and real clean, and let's. But it gets into more and more grooming. You know, shaping the eyebrows and plucking hair and trying to this I gotta look this way or something. And so there is that situation.
What channel is that?
I'm not sure. Seven, maybe.
Seven?
No, 38. Okay.
There's nothing.
Yeah, and that's okay. That's okay. You know, don't worry about that. Don't worry about it. You know, there are some basic differences in people's, you know, focus on grooming. How do I look and everything? Just keep up just a basic norm. Just keep up a basic norm. Don't focus on it anymore. Drop it. It's right spiritual practice that is important. Once you do that, right spiritual practice, you'll say, "Hey, I love this," and then you'll automatically will feel better about it. You'll automatically feel better about it, and you'll focus more and more on right spiritual practice, and the rest doesn't matter that much. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. There's not a bunch of flowers everywhere. Doesn't matter. The decoration doesn't really matter. Whatever. You know. It's not important. We're not form. We're not time. We're not space. We're not process. We're not form. Never will be. This world has nothing to teach us at all, except to teach us that it has nothing to teach us. All right? We can use this world to become aware that it has nothing to teach us. That's what miracles are for. That's what miracles are for. How are we doing here? We're doing pretty good. That's what miracles are all about, is to realize that this cosmos, electromagnetic cosmos, has nothing to teach us. Has nothing for us. Has nothing for us whatsoever. And we can use this dream to show us it has nothing for us. To show us that it has nothing for us, actually. Except an honoring of our creativity. But no lessons to learn, nothing for us, no value whatsoever for us, has no value. Truly, this cosmos has no value for us. That's right. This electromagnetic universe has no value for us. We are spirit. We're free. We're still exactly as God created us to be. We're not time, space, process, or form at all. This doesn't exist. This dream has no value to us, except we can use it to help us see, gently help us see that it doesn't have any value for us. And we say, "Ah, that's okay then. I'm okay with that." We can use it that way. So I say, prepare for time not to start. Jesus came here, says, "I am here to prepare you for time not to start." This is a new orientation you have towards the cosmos. Is you no longer are seeing it as having any value. You're now going to see it as having no value. Because time is not going to start. The only value this could ever have is if time actually did start. Then we could say, "Oh, that was a very valuable exercise we went through with that cosmos, you know, at this dream universe. It's very valuable for us because it prepared us for time." But other than that, you know, since it's not going to start, time doesn't have any value. was getting pressured there. Game started. Where is the game? I gotta watch the game. No. Let it start. It doesn't matter who wins or loses. There's no value to this cosmos. It's more important to point out there's no value to this cosmos at all. None. Except we can use it to become aware that it has no value in a gentle way, So it's the age of miracles, the sheep and the goats. The goats will continue to ramp up their celebration of time and thinking that anything goes and trying to get ready for time to start. And the sheep will say, hey, no, time's never going to start. There's no such thing as time. So we need to recognize there's no value in this cosmos at all, this dream. And we're going to gently now prepare for time not to start, and we'll give a different purpose to the cosmos. Now it's a cosmos of miracles. Cosmos of miracles. Which gently highlight the unreality of this, that it's a dream. So there's a big difference, right, between the sheep and the goats. Huge difference. Obviously, there's going to be a difference between those who are getting ready for time to start and those who realize that there's no such thing as time. Obviously, there's going to be a gigantic difference in purpose and orientation and ideology, right? Of course. That's why the world, those who are preparing for time to start, have been very, very mistrustful of Christians throughout history. The Romans, my gosh, a lot of the Roman emperors were very, very mistrustful of Christians. They said we don't like them. We're getting ready for time to start, and what the heck are they doing? We don't understand them. So they're very frightened and scared and mistrustful of them. This is the attitude right now of today. There's an extreme distrust of Christianity right now, because the prevailing times are that of we're just about ready for time to start, and so it's extremely important that everybody gets on the same page and we can help one another out here. If you don't do that, you're terrible. What the hell's the matter with Christians? They're saying they're not helping us out. They're crazy or something. They're not doing anything to get ready for time. They're lunatics. And this is the ideology right now. People are getting more and more strident in their criticisms of religious and Christians in particular. More and more strident. Now, I exhort all those who are on the path, exhort them to do better. So I can be admonished. I can admonish it through exhorting, saying, hey, you got to do better. You got to meet the challenge more every day. There's a you cannot mix truth and lies. That's not the way. So, but I'm not criticizing religion the way that those who believe in time are criticizing it. They have a deep hatred of it and fear of it and loathing of it, and they want to destroy it. I want to make it better. I want to make it successful, and that get prepared for time not to start. Get into that. You have to get into that now because of the times. The times we're in is so ferocious. Those who believe time is about ready to start any day, they say any day time could start. Well, guess what? Jesus already came back around May 1st, and time hasn't started. He didn't start time. His arrival did not start time. That should cause a lot of people to start thinking, hey, wait a minute. Maybe Jesus is not coming back to start time. Maybe he's coming back to harvest those who realize that there's no such thing as time. And, like he said he would. Maybe he's came back to do what he said he would do. So this is a lot to take in, but You know, hopefully some of this is resonating. It caused a resonation, and that resonation will continue and just keep the ball rolling. That's the name of the game. That's the name of the game. So full stop in the wow. The resonation of this is strong. I'm feeling very, very strong. Very strong. It's hitting me now. You know, the truth is getting more intense as we go closer to the imaginary starting of time. The maniacs in the world are so sure it's about ready to start. There, as they amp up their preparations, you know, the pressure on everybody in the world gets very intense. And so to combat that, the medicine, you know, the antidote has to also become very intense. And you realize what the stakes are here. You know, being really conservative, that is the new hip. That is the new hip. That is what's in. Or just being naturally conservative. Just being naturally conservative. Don't. It's not forced. You just know none of that stuff. I don't want to be part of it. It doesn't work. That's not the answer. I know there is an answer. So I'm going to keep working at that. I know I can make these assertions that are going to evaporate the continuity fear. I do have the right spiritual tools to get the job done. Everything released in the now. Cosmos released in the now. Time released in the now. Time doesn't exist. I can't release it in the now. Time released in the now. Belief in time released in the now. worlds released in the now. Solar system released in the now. Sun released in the now. Light released in the now. Darkness released in the now. Exertion released in the now. Celebration released in the now. Parties released in the now. Preparation released in the now. Expectation released in the now. Fear released in the now. Hope released in the now. Waiting released in the now. See, we have these techniques here that will work. That will work. These are extraordinarily effective, profound techniques. And there's nothing preventing us from doing it. So to say that you know that there's no such thing as time and will never start is absolute heresy to the prevailing ideologies of the world. So just be a natural heretic, you know, be a natural heretic and don't try and, you know, try to force anything, you know, just continue on this path that they think is heresy. We know it's true. And heresy released in the now. False paths released in the now. All paths released in the now. All attainment released in the now. All recognition released in the now. All accomplishment released in the now. All success released in the now. All effort released in the now. All trying released in the now. All struggle released in the now. All temptations released in the now. All delusion released in the now. All clarity released in the now. So, work on all sides of duality. Even all confusion released in the now. All clarity released in the now. Everything released in the now. All released in the now. all imperfection released in the now. All perfection released in the now. All ideology released in the now. All nothingness released in the now. All everythingness released in the now. All trials released in the now. All tribulations released in the now. All exaltation released in the now. All triumph released in the now. All winning released in the now. All losing released in the now. All success released in the now. All failure released in the now. All elation released in the now. All depression released in the now. All hope released in the now. All despair released in the now. All homes released in the now. All homelessness released in the now. All lostness released in the now. All foundness released in the now. All security released in the now. All insecurity released in the now. All beginnings released in the now. All endings released in the now. All nature released in the now. All energy released in the now. All dynamics released in the now. All laws released in the now. All chemistry released in the now. All biology released in the now. All nature released in the now. All physics released in the now. All astronomy released in the now. All astrology released in the now. All relationship released in the now. All chaos released in the now. All choice released in the now. All freedom released in the now. All bondage released in the now. All trouble released in the now. All ease released in the now. All concern released in the now. All non-concern released in the now. All thoughts released in the now. All thoughts released in the now. All thoughts released in the now. All images released in the now. All concepts released in the now. All valuing released in the now. All form released in the now. All space released in the now. All process released in the now. All time belief released in the now. All form released in the now. All process released in the now. All process released in the now. All relationship released in the now. All beingness released in the now. All awareness released in the now. All consciousness released in the now. All bodies released in the now. All vibration released in the now. All vibration released in the now. All vibration released in the now. So this is pushing some buttons for sure. This is designed to push buttons here. We're designed, our purpose is to push the buttons so we can experience the wow, the intensity of it. So we're at full stop in the wow mode here. This is, it got very intense. All concreteness released in the now. All abstraction released in the now. All abstraction released in the now. All tragedy released in the now. All celebration released in the now. All flowers released in the now. All music released in the now. All sensation released in the now. All sensation released in the now. All reaction released in the now. All feeling released in the now. All thinking released in the now. All conflict released in the now. All conflict released now. All peace released in the now. All hatred released in the now. All love released in the now. All affection released in the now. All disaffection released in the now. All strategy released in the now. All plans released in the now. All projection released in the now. All structure released in the now. All design released in the now. All details released in the now. All complexity released in the now. All simplicity released in the now. All obviousness released in the now. All obscuration released in the now. All spirituality released in the now. All doubts released in the now. All assurance is released in the now. All expectations released in the now. All change released in the now. All words released in the now. All words released in the now. All numbers released in the now. All calculation released in the now. All location released in the now. All places released in the now. So don't be afraid to not prepare for time, to just say, no, I don't need to do that, because we have the tools we need here to bring the intensity we need, don't we? We absolutely have these tools. This is very intense. When you're in this sort of intensity, you're not thinking, well, how do I look? How do I look? How do I look? Not really. It's not really important. All appearance released in the now. All appearance released in the now. All modification released in the now. All fashion released in the now. All appearance released in the now. All appearance released in the now. All appearance released in the now. All disappearance released in the now. All disappearance released in the now. Now, I put this practice at the end of the video. It seems appropriate for those who have watched the whole video, which means they have the right stuff to handle this sort of intensity. The dilettantes, you know, will maybe watch the first 3 minutes and then that's it. But it's only the ones who feel very confident and grounded in managing their success who are willing to watch the whole thing. And then at the end, you get this very intense practice, which should be very, very helpful in showing you and helping you realize and experience we have the tools we need. We have the tools we need. We're not rank amateurs or dilettantes here. This practice is intensely profound and helpful. And I have the assurance not of more than just one teacher that this is so. If just one teacher saying, yeah, you say, well, is there anyone else who believes this? Yes, there is, absolutely. So Jesus isn't the only one who says this is supremely effective. He certainly says that, certainly points out. He's not the only one. There are others who also recognize that this type of practicing like this is tremendously helpful. You know, trust but verify. Why not? Why not get reinforcement? We need at this time reinforcing. Yeah, this will work. This will work. Christianity is under such severe attack that people are wavering, you know, wavering. And they say, well, maybe this is the way, this is the way. Well, guess what? There are other teachers from other traditions who also recognize that this is the way, who are backing up Jesus and saying, absolutely, this is correct. Jesus says, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. You know, I'm not a body, and I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Practice, practice, practice. And so, people are claiming that, you know, Jesus isn't this. Well, there are teachers from other great traditions who are backing them up on this. So, this is right. It does work. This is profound. Release everything into the now and allow this whole dream to prepare you for time not to start. So full stop on the wow with this, you know, this is it gave you full intensity here, full intensity. And being able to sustain this intensity and to handle it gives us tremendous confidence going forward. Any great teacher that would come here in the world, what more intensity can they suggest to us than something like that?